Welcome to Chapter 3, Developing a Global Vision. Global marketing means marketing to target markets throughout the world, and it's an imperative for almost every business. Managers have to recognize and react to international opportunities as well as to foreign competition via imports, which is found in almost every industry. In addition, marketing executives have to understand how customer and supplier networks operate worldwide. The word global has assumed a new meaning, referring to a boundless mobility and competition in social, business, and intellectual arenas. Global vision means recognizing and reacting to international marketing opportunities, being aware of threats from foreign competitors in all markets, and effectively using international distribution networks. While reviewing this chapter, just keep in mind a few questions, like what are our options in selling abroad, how difficult is global marketing, and what are the potential risks and returns? About 85% of all U.S. exports are made by 250 companies. All totaled, there are only 25,000 companies that export their goods on a regular basis. Most small and medium-sized firms are essentially non-participants in global trade and marketing. Many companies find a steady opportunity for growth in foreign markets, however. 3M has doubled its export sales in the last 5 years and is building or buying plants in a variety of countries, from Germany to Australia. American fast food companies have also found growth markets on an international basis as the market has become more saturated in the United States. If you've done much traveling abroad, you probably know that it's almost impossible to go anywhere without finding a McDonald's. Despite all the attributes of global trade, there are millions of Americans who vehemently oppose global trade, and it mainly has to do with jobs. Millions of Americans have lost jobs, and millions more fear losing their jobs to companies that can operate at a much lower cost because they can pay people in other countries to work at a much lower rate. But there are also tremendous advantages to world trade, such as improved standards of living for all countries involved, increased productivity, lower prices for all consumers, and an increased motivation to compete. A multinational corporation is a company that is heavily engaged in international trade. For example, about 80% of Coca-Cola's operating earnings come from abroad. The company now makes more money in Japan than in the United States. Coca-Cola is a true multinational. It sells in almost every country in the world. Multinational corporations are able to move resources, goods, services, and skills across national borders without regard to the country in which the headquarters is located. Usually, multinational corporations are enormous, with sales larger than the gross domestic product of most countries of the world. Large multinational corporations have many advantages over other companies. First, they can overcome trade problems. They may be able to sidestep regulatory problems in certain countries by establishing divisions that operate as local firms. They may save a great deal in labor costs by moving some operations to low-cost countries. They can shift costs from one plant to another, and they can tap new technology from around the world. Global marketing is defined as individuals and organizations using a global vision to effectively market their goods and services across national borders. Global marketing standardization presumes that the markets throughout the world are becoming more and more alike and that globally standardized products can be sold the same way all over the world. Some markets and products, such as McDonald's, Pepsi, and Coca-Cola, do seem to fit global market standardization concepts. Industrial and high-tech products are also likely to be marketed globally in a standardized manner. In 1991, IBM decided to use virtually identical microcomputer ads throughout Europe, changing only the language to suit each country. The company states that it's striving for a single image. Most firms try to identify, yet minimize, needed product modifications from country to country. Advertising usually differs in each market. Coca-Cola is often held to be an example of global standardization. However, Coca-Cola has discovered the need to allow local managers to adjust the product mix in order to compete with local brands and appeal to local tastes. For example, in Spain, it is used heavily as a mixer, even for wine, and it is advertised as such. In Italy, Coca-Cola is increasingly drunk with meals in place of wine or cappuccino. Now let's look a little closer at the external environment facing global marketing executives. Central to any society is its culture, the common set of values shared by its citizens that determines what is socially acceptable. Many people within a culture don't realize the norms that have been established until outsiders break them. Culture forms the basis for the family, educational, religious, and social class systems. Culture significantly influences the marketing mix. Without understanding a country's culture, a company has little chance of effectively penetrating the market. Societies that foster individuality are often very lucrative for marketers of personal care products and fashion clothing. With each consumer striving to be unique, fashions can change constantly. Marketers of these products would have to modify their approach if the chosen market values conformity over individuality. Important aspects to consider are the meaning and significance of language and slang terms, difficulties in translation, etiquette, and negotiation procedures. Differences in culture may expose marketing opportunities. In Japanese culture, a traveler must buy gifts and souvenirs for family, friends, and business associates. To make gift buying more convenient, several airlines, including Northwest, Qantas, Cathay Pacific, offer catalogs of souvenirs that can be delivered directly to travelers' homes when they return. Not understanding a culture's notion of time can sometimes lead to situations that are awkward and embarrassing. In some cultures, being 5 or 10 minutes late to a meeting is very acceptable, whereas in other cultures it's considered very unprofessional or disrespectful. Also, in some cultures, time spent getting to know a new acquaintance isn't a waste of time, but considered necessary in order to trust the person whom you're dealing with. This can be sometimes difficult for managers in the United States who are used to getting down to business immediately. In general, complex and sophisticated industries and higher family incomes are found in developed countries, and more basic industries and lower incomes are found in less developed nations. The five stages of economic growth and technological development are traditional, pre-industrial, takeoff, industrializing, and fully industrial. I'll describe each further in the following slides. The traditional society is largely agricultural with a social structure and a value system that provide little opportunity for upward mobility. It is custom-bound, and its economy typically operates at the subsistence level because of primitive or no technology. The pre-industrial society is characterized by economic and social change and the emergence of a rising middle class with an entrepreneurial spirit. Nationalism may also emerge, hindering the entrance of multinational corporations. The takeoff economy is the period of transition from a developing to a developed nation. New industries arise, and a generally healthy social and political climate emerges. The industrializing society is characterized by the spread of technology to most sectors of the economy. Capital goods and consumer goods begin to be produced. A large middle class arises, and the demand for luxuries and services grows. The fully industrialized society is an exporter of manufactured products, many of which are based on advanced technology. The wealth of industrialized nations creates tremendous market potential. Government policies in other countries run the gamut from no private ownership and minimal individual freedom to little central government and maximum personal freedom. It might be the difference between Cuba and the United States. As rights of private property increase, government-owned industries and centralized planning tend to decrease. The early 90s were characterized by a large group of countries in Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union moving from centralized planning or communism, to market economies like the United States, opening up market opportunities for many firms. A threat to some firms engaged in global marketing is the growth of nationalist sentiment in countries where citizens have strong loyalties and devotion to their country. Foreign firms can lose the right to conduct business in those countries. Other problems have been when companies move into countries where the governments are fairly unstable, and a military coup can take over a country and take over the companies that are doing business there, and that's obviously a huge financial loss for businesses. This happened to DuPont in Argentina several years ago, and other companies. The first McDonald's restaurant in Moscow opened in early 1990. It was immediately a huge hit with the Russians. It is the largest McDonald's in the world, with over 700 seats inside and 200 seats outside. It employs 630 and can serve 30,000 people a day. Negotiating with the Soviet government for permission to open the restaurant took 14 years. Legal structures are often closely intertwined with the political environment, and they're designed to either encourage or limit trade. Brazil, which controls about 20% of the world's coffee, surprised coffee makers in 1991 by saying it would take steps to limit sales and push up prices. Brazil immediately curtailed its shipments to other countries until negotiations for new contracts could begin. The North American Free Trade Agreement, or NAFTA, is the world's largest free trade zone. It includes Canada, the United States, and Mexico, and together they have a population of 360 million and an economy of $6 trillion. When NAFTA went into effect, tariffs on many items disappeared, and a web of licensing requirements and quotas were lifted. The first industries to benefit were automobiles, textiles, capital goods, financial services, construction equipment, electronics, telecommunications, and petrochemicals. Countries south of the U.S. border have been forming their own trade agreements. The largest new trade agreement is Mercosur, which includes Brazil, Argentina, Uruguay, and Paraguay. The European Union is a group of 12 countries that have lifted most internal trade barriers. Its members include Belgium, France, Germany, Italy, Luxembourg, the Netherlands, Denmark, Ireland, Spain, the United Kingdom, Portugal, and Greece. The European Union has been evolving for nearly four decades. It is an attractive market with 320 million consumers and purchasing power almost equal to the United States. However, it is full of diversity. The European Union proposed allowing comparative advertising to create a single market for advertising. Comparative advertising is common in the United States, but has been very rare in Europe. It is often banned or deemed unfair in Belgium, Luxembourg, Germany, Italy, and Greece. The Maastricht Treaty of 1993 proposed to take the European Union further toward economic, monetary, and political union. The treaty standardized trade rules and taxes, health and safety standards, duties, custom procedures, and product testing. One problem facing United States marketers is the possibility of a protectionist movement by the European Union against outsiders. Rivalry is very intense in the European Union. Demographic makeup is comprised of many factors that marketing executives have to consider. Population is one of them. The three most densely populated nations in the world are China, India, and Indonesia. It's also important to consider whether the population is urban or rural. Urban populations are usually more attractive to marketers because marketers have easier access to these populations. The amount and distribution of income within a country is also important. It's an indicator of its market potential. The wealthiest nations include Japan, the United States, Switzerland, Sweden, Canada, Germany, and several of the Arab oil-producing nations. Even countries with very low per capita incomes have pockets of extremely affluent consumers. The largest population increases are in the developing nations, not in the industrialized countries. The abundance of natural resources in some countries can create huge amounts of personal wealth. Many oil-rich nations experienced an influx of wealth during the 1970s, but their economies suffered in the 1980s when the price of oil fell. Other countries are hampered by their dependence on imports for many raw metals, timber, agricultural products, and other raw materials. So why do companies go global? To earn additional profits, to leverage a unique product or technological advantage, to possess exclusive market information, and to utilize economies of scale. A firm can adopt one of several possible structures when considering global marketing. These structures fall along a continuum of levels of risk and possible return involved. There are different types of risks, as well as the different methods of entry. A company should consider moving to the global arena only after its management has a solid grasp of the global environment. A firm has five basic methods for entering the global marketplace: export, licensing, contract manufacturing, joint venture, and direct investment. Exporting is selling domestically produced products in another country. It is usually the least complicated and least risky alternative for entering the global market. A company can sell directly to foreign importers or buyers, or it may decide to sell to an independent exporting intermediary located in its domestic market. The most common intermediary is the export merchant, also known as the buyer for export, who is usually treated like a domestic customer by the domestic manufacturer. The buyer for export assumes all risks and sells internationally for its own account. Another type of intermediary is the export agent or broker, who plays the traditional broker's role by bringing the buyer and seller together without taking title to or possession of the goods. An export broker operates primarily in agriculture and raw materials. An export agent may be a foreign sales agent distributor, similar to a domestic manufacturer's agent, but living in the market country, or a resident agent in the manufacturer's country for foreign buyers. Licensing is a legal process whereby a licensor agrees to let another firm use its manufacturing process, trademarks, patents, trade secrets, or other proprietary knowledge. The licensee agrees to pay a fee or royalty. Licensing is less risky than direct manufacturing in the foreign country. The licensor must make certain it can exercise the control over the licensee's activities needed to ensure proper quality, pricing, distribution, and so on. Franchising is one form of licensing that has grown rapidly in recent years. Over 350 U.S. franchisors operate more than 32,000 outlets in foreign countries. Fast food represents a fast-growing segment of international licensing. Some firms become heavily involved in global marketing by subcontracting the manufacturing to a firm in the foreign country. Contract manufacturing is simply private label manufacturing by a foreign company that affixes the parent company's names to the goods. The parent company markets the goods. The garment industry utilizes contract manufacturing to a large degree. In a joint venture, the domestic firm buys part of a foreign company or joins with a foreign company to create a new business. Joint ventures, although financially risky, give management a voice in company affairs that it might not have under licensing. The partner that learns the fastest comes to dominate the relationship and can then rewrite its terms. This is a new form of competition and a chance to learn. Mazda, the fourth largest Japanese automaker, has entered into several joint ventures with companies such as Ford, Citroen, and Suzuki. Coors Brewing Company entered into a joint venture with a Korean brewery to tap into the fast-growing beer market in Korea. One global success story is the aircraft manufacturer Airbus Industry, which is a partnership of British, French, German, and Spanish companies. The firm has become the second largest maker of commercial jets in the world, after Boeing, and has a 30% global market share. When Airbus Industry was formed in 1970, inefficiency, confusion, and nationalistic fights over appointments initially threatened its success, but the firm has survived. Employees and managers have had to learn how co-workers from other cultures work and how to adapt their styles of management and manufacturing. Direct foreign investment is the active ownership of a foreign company or of an overseas manufacturing facility. This offers the greatest potential rewards and the greatest risks. The large investment may be a tremendous financial downfall. A firm may want to acquire an existing foreign firm in order to acquire personnel or some other valuable resource. The United States is a popular place for direct investment by foreign companies. About 30 U.S. universities have set up branch campuses in Japan, another type of direct export by investment. Examples are Temple University, Los Angeles Community College, Edmonds Community College, and Rio Grande College. Another example, Coca-Cola decided to build plants in Eastern Europe rather than just ship Coke from the West because of a belief in corporate social responsibility. The firm wanted to be part of the unemployment solution in Eastern Europe. Coke is spending $450 million to start 5 bottling plants and 13 to 15 distribution centers. The first step in creating a global marketing mix is to thoroughly understand the global target market. Often, this understanding can be accomplished with global marketing research. Global marketing research uses the same tools as domestic research. However, obtaining a sample can be very difficult in developing countries where telephone ownership is rare and mail service is slow or sporadic. Differences in culture may also affect the ability of the research to collect data. But despite all the pitfalls, many companies have gone global. Eddie Bauer going to Germany, L.L. Bean sending catalogs to Japan, and J. Crew attacking the French, the catalog retail industry is adopting a global strategy. When one of the most successful companies goes global, the entire catalog industry is tempted to follow suit. Some companies have a global marketing strategy of one product, one message. This strategy, essentially the global standardization strategy, fits certain products. A slight alteration of advertising or certain changes in packaging and labeling may still take place, however. In the context of global marketing, product invention can be taken to mean either creating a whole new product or drastically changing an existing product for a market. Many firms use a strategy of changing messages or message adaptation. While some firms use the same promotional strategy worldwide and alter products to fit each market, the promotional strategy takes a standardized product but stresses different customer benefits according to the different markets that they're applying it to, or use varying approaches that take into account cultural differences. Marketing executives using this strategy have to understand things like language barriers, translation problems, and cultural differences that have generated numerous headaches for international managers. Product adaptation is another alternative for global marketers to meet local conditions. Flavors may be changed, or colors or packaging may be altered. In Japan, Domino's Pizza offers a fermented milk drink that is very popular. They also offer pizza with toppings to appeal to the Japanese consumer's palate. Pricing in the international market must take into account the extra transportation costs, insurance costs, taxes, and tariffs. Because many people in developing nations lack purchasing power, the global firm must decide if it can cut costs and still produce a product that the market will buy. Some companies overproduce certain items and end up dumping them in the international market. Dumping occurs when products are sold either below cost or below their selling price in the domestic market. The Uruguay Round rewrote the international law on dumping. It's illegal, but countries still engage in this practice. In the 1970s, the Japanese sold televisions in the United States for below cost, driving U.S. TV makers out of business. Now such practices are dealt with quickly by the U.S. government. Countertrade, a form of trade in which all or part of the payment for goods or services is in the form of other goods and services. This is very popular in international markets. It's estimated that almost 30% of global trade is countertrade. This means that no money is exchanged. Goods or services are exchanged for other companies' goods and services on a worldwide level. Some foreign distribution systems offer United States firms many challenges. The Japanese system is considered the most complicated in the world. Imported goods wind their way through layers of agents, wholesalers, and retailers decreed by historical patterns and social relationships. The government-subsidized German Postal Service effectively blocked Federal Express as it attempted to set up operations in Europe. The German Postal Service can deliver packages overnight for up to 65% less than Federal Express. Retail institutions overseas may also differ from what a company is accustomed to in its domestic market. U.S.-type retail outlets may be unavailable or impractical in developing countries. Customers may have different shopping habits. Many developing nations' distribution channels and physical infrastructure are also very inadequate. Some nations just may not even have roads that are acceptable to deliver goods. Coca-Cola executives describe Eastern Germany as a region with terrible telephones, roads, and pollution. One of the reasons that a national brand of beer has not become popular in China is because the brewers don't have access to highways and refrigerated trucks. Shipping by rail ruins beer quality. Therefore, the beer brands in China are still regional. The internet has, of course, had a huge impact on global marketing. Opening an e-commerce site on the internet immediately puts a company in an international marketplace, but there are still many things that marketing executives have to consider. Consumer shopping habits differ on a worldwide basis and must be accommodated by the e-tailer. Payment mechanisms must be adapted for those who are not credit card users. Pricing restrictions in different countries affect consumers' choice of purchase sites. There has arisen a market in e-money where consumers use a debit-type card that can only be used for internet purchases. American Express has developed a credit card which can only be used for a single transaction and is then automatically canceled so that there is no way for the number to be used without the holder's knowledge. Business-to-business internet commerce has implications for the enforcement of tax collection and product import quotas.